friends. You know, I am so excited to connect with you today on this platform. Today, I'll be speaking to you on the subject spiritual gifts. We all like to receive some gifts from our parents, from friends and families and people who like us and who admire us and who want to be a blessing to us. The same way our Heavenly Father loves us to give us gifts. To enjoy, yes, but also to make us more effective in the kingdom of God and as we serve Him. This is what we call spiritual gifts. They come alongside the blessed Holy Spirit to be able to make us effective, if you would, at the cutting edge in terms of extending the kingdom of God. I want you to stay tuned. Don't touch that dial. I want you to be blessed so that you can discover what God has given you so that you can be a blessing in the kingdom of God. God bless you.
Yeah. Bwana asifiwe sana.
Amen.
Thank you so much. Senior pastor, Reverend Charles Tobara is coming to minister to us. Amen.
Praise the Lord, church. Bwana asifiwe. Are you happy to be in the house of the Lord? Amen, amen. We want to thank you, senior pastor, the entire team, for giving us an opportunity to come and minister. The song that we're about to minister, it talks about, we want to hear more about God, hungry and thirsty of our Lord Jesus Christ. And our prayer is that the Lord God will fill you as we minister. God bless you.
Lord, I'm thirsty. for you, we yearn for you as a deer pants for the water brook. Nothing else can satisfy the deep yearning of our hearts. Nothing else can quench our spiritual thirst apart from your presence, O God, apart from your anointing in our lives, O God. So we ask you today in Jesus' name that you will fill us afresh, that you'll move in our midst, King of glory, to do only that which you can do this morning. I abandon myself to you as a jar of clay, a vessel, O God, that you may use me to be able to share your word under the anointing of God as I should. To this very end, I commit myself and I ask for your divine enablement. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen and amen. Good morning, Sitam Karen.
Morning.
It's a joy to see you in the house of the Lord. Did you have a good week?
Yes.
Amen. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
All the time.
Amen and amen. God is at work in Sitam Karen. On Wednesday, we had amazing testimonies of how God moved in the last week to heal people, to set people free, and to fill them with His blessed Holy Spirit during the revival week. How many of you experienced the touch of God in form of healing, in form of baptism of the Holy Spirit, or in form of deliverance, or some special touch from the presence of God? You are here, God touched you over the past week. Couple of hands going up. Thank you, thank you, thank you. God is doing a new thing in Sitam Karen. I want to drink more of Him. I am yearning for more of Him. I am not satisfied with dew, with drizzles. I am longing for the mighty outpouring of the Spirit of the living God. Don't settle for less than what God has in store for you. It's a season of revival in Sitam Karen. If I were you, I would have said a louder, enthusiastic amen. Amen means let it be so. You are affirming the truth of God's word. Amen.
Amen.
We began this month by focusing on the series about the Holy Spirit. We began off by looking at the ministry of the Holy Spirit. The second Sunday, we considered the emblems of the Holy Spirit. And last Sunday, we looked at the subject, the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Today, by the grace of God, we'll be considering the subject, the gifts of the Holy Spirit. The gifts of the Holy Spirit. It's very interesting that Paul the Apostle devotes three chapters in 1 Corinthians to talk about spiritual gifts. Chapter 12, chapter 13, and chapter 14. He also talks about the same in Romans chapter 12 and also in Ephesians chapter 4. That means that for the Apostle Paul, spiritual gifts and matters, Holy Ghost was so central in his ministry. We will do well to pay attention to this subject. What is a spiritual gift? When God fills you with His Spirit, alongside the baptism of the Holy Spirit, comes in an extra package called a spiritual gift. Over and above the infilling of the Holy Spirit, that comes with an extra package called spiritual gift. Some of you have gone to supermarkets where you buy maybe some whole grain for a cereal for breakfast or cereals for breakfast, and there's something else attached to that package. It's on offer. All right? You buy one, you get one
free.
So spiritual gifts are extra resources, not an addendum. Extra resources given for a specific purpose in the body of Christ. Now, Ken Hemphill defined individual expression or manifestation of the Spirit of God that enables you to play a vital role in God's redemptive plan, in God's grander scheme of things, in God's plan of redemption of humanity. He has given us the Holy Spirit to be able to help us to fulfill our mission, our calling, and our assignment here on earth. So the spiritual gift helps you to play a vital, a critical, a crucial role in God's mission or redemption of humanity here on earth. How many of you desire not to be a statistic in God's great agenda, but to play some crucial role in God's plan here on earth? Almost all of you. To enable you to deliver on this great mandate, to enable you to fulfill your assignment here on earth, God gives you, besides the infilling of the Holy Spirit, that extra enablement, that extra action to be able to fulfill your assignment. Peter Wagner, Professor Peter Wagner, the professor of church growth in Fuller Theological Seminary, defines a spiritual gift as a special attribute given by the Holy Spirit to every member of the body of Christ according to God's grace for use within the context of the body of Christ. It is that special attribute given by the Holy Spirit to individual members of the body of Christ, or simply put, to Christians, so that they can fulfill or play a special role in the body of Christ. A spiritual gift is an expression of the Holy Spirit in the life of the believer, which empowers you to be able to serve. So the action to be able to serve or play a role in the body of Christ is what we call the spiritual gift. So what is the purpose of spiritual gifts? Why are spiritual gifts given? Spiritual gifts are given for building up, for edifying, for strengthening, for nourishing the body of Christ. Spiritual gifts are given for building up, for edifying, for nourishing, and for strengthening the body of Christ. The body of Christ is not built on human ingenuity or wisdom. It's not by science and learning and experience. It's not human energy at best. No, the body of Christ is built by spiritual gifts, by the divine enablement of God through His blessed Holy Spirit. That's how we do church. Education, training, learning, and experience has its place, but that is not the foundation upon which the body of Christ is built and established. It's by the blessed Holy Spirit through the diverse manifestation of the Spirit of God. Paul said, I do not want your faith to rest on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Our faith cannot rest on human ingenuity, human eloquence, but on the power of God. And that power of God is manifested through the diverse expressions of the Holy Spirit. Let's look at some attributes or some of the characteristics of the nature of spiritual gifts. What are some of the attributes of spiritual gifts? Number one, spiritual gifts are divine abilities. Spiritual gifts are divine abilities. It's not the power of education, the power of science and technology that delivers in serving God. Those are just vehicles and instruments that can be used or channels. But spiritual gifts are divine abilities. It's not intelligence. Secondly, spiritual gifts are diverse. There are over 24 kinds of spiritual gifts, and that is highlighted in 1 Corinthians 12. verse 1 all the way to 12, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 to 16, and Romans, the 12th chapter, verse 6 to 8. We have gifts of wisdom, knowledge, faith, healing, working of miracles, prophecy, discerning of spirits, tongues, and interpretation, administration, teaching, pastoral, exhortation, giving, gifts of wisdom, mercy, EDC, and of thinking capacity. I want to challenge you in the course of this week to read 1 Corinthians chapter 12, chapter 13, and chapter 14, and also Ephesians chapter 4, and also Romans chapter 12, where these spiritual gifts are taught about. Thirdly, what is the attribute, the nature, or the characteristics of spiritual gifts? Now, spiritual gifts are discretionally given by the Holy Spirit. They are sovereignly or discretionally given by the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 12, 11. All this, referring to spiritual gifts, all these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and He gives them to each one just as He determines. It is a prerogative of the Holy Spirit to give certain individual specific expressions, specific manifestation of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. It is Him who determines, sovereignly, discretionally given by the Holy Spirit. Fourthly, spiritual gifts are designed for common good or to profit all. They're intended not for us to feel good about them, but to be a blessing to people for common good. 1 Corinthians 12, 7 to 8. Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit or the gift of the Spirit is given for common good. Some translation says to profit all. When you have a spiritual gift, that makes you to be a blessing to the body of Christ. What makes you to be a resource, what makes you to be an instrument, what makes you to be an asset in the kingdom of God, what makes you to be a blessing in the body of Christ is that special attribute, that special expression of the Spirit of God that enables you to make a significant contribution in the kingdom of God. That is what makes you to be a blessing. If you are born again, you are a child of God, God has filled you with His blessed Spirit and given you some gifts, you are a blessing in the body of Christ. You are a blessing. You better believe it. You are a blessing because God has given you something that is intended to bless the body of Christ. That makes you a blessing. You have something to bring to the table that can bless the body of Christ. Amen. It's good to see I am blessed. I am blessed when I wake up in the morning. I am blessed. You better begin singing, I am a blessing. I am a blessing. Every moment of my life, I am a blessing. I am here to be a blessing. Hallelujah. Whatever God takes me, I'm going to be a blessing. Hallelujah. I'm going to bless people. I'm going to be a channel and a conduit of God's blessings to their lives. When you begin to perceive yourself that way, you move from being a negative and critical and judgmental individual to be an asset and a resource in the kingdom of God. It calls for a paradigm shift. You're not a problem. Okay? You're here to bless us. Every last one of you, you're here to bless us. Because God has given you a gift that is intended to bless and to benefit all people. Number five, the gifts, spiritual gifts, are to be desired. They should be desired. 1 Corinthians 12, 31. but eagerly desire spiritual gifts. Eagerly desire the greater gifts. We'll talk about which gifts are those. 1 Corinthians 14:12 says, since you are eager to have spiritual gifts, try to excel in gifts that build up the church. Since you're eager, since you're enthusiastic, Paul is telling the Corinthian believers, since you're enthusiastic in the subject of spiritual gifts, desire or excel in gifts that build the body of Christ most. Now, there are categories of gifts. We're going to look at these. There are gifts that are intended to build you up, to encourage others, but there are other gifts that edify most the body of Christ. We will look at those categories in a short while. Honestly, desire spiritual gifts. Ask. He gives sovereignly, but you need to ask. Desire. Long for. Number six. Spiritual gifts are to be deployed or used. They need to be employed or deployed in the service of the kingdom of God. 1 Timothy 4:14. Do not neglect your gift. Do not neglect your gift, which was given you through a prophetic message when the body of elders laid their hands on you. Timothy is being challenged by his spiritual father. Do not sleep on that gift. Do not neglect. Do not abandon. Do not ignore the gift that was imparted on you when the body of church leaders laid their hands on you. Use it. So employ it. You must use it. Number seven, spiritual gifts can be or should be developed. Spiritual gifts should be developed. 2 Timothy again, 1:6-7. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. I remind you to fan to flame. The best image that comes to my mind quickly is how you light a charcoal stove. What do you do? Put some charcoal and some life coals, and then you begin fanning, pepeta, pepeta, pepeta. As you fan, as you pepeta, then the whole jiggle catches fire, and then the stove is now aglow and aflame, and you can use the fire to be able to fix your meal or cook your githeri. Fan to flame. Use. Develop the gift that is in you. Many of us have been gifted uniquely and diversely, but sometimes we are not aware of what God has given us, and for the most part, those gifts remain dormant. There are many dormant gifts in the house. This season is a season of starting you up. To rise up and use what God has given you to be a blessing in the body of Christ. Fan to flame. The better that gift, use it, engage it. How do you fan it to flame? By using it. Exercise your spiritual gift. Spiritual gifts are like muscles. Shikwembe, okay? You got to exercise, do the gym and do all that to build your biceps and triceps. Exercise. If you do not do that, your muscles will not develop. So you need to exercise your gift for it to be able to be developed. Now, as I mentioned, spiritual gifts are many and diverse, but we want to group them into three broader categories. The first one is the gifts of revelation. The gifts of revelation. Secondly, gifts of power. And thirdly, gifts of inspiration. The gifts of revelation would include a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge, and discerning of spirits. And secondly, the gifts of power would entail faith, working of miracles, and the gifts of healing. Thirdly, the third category, the gifts of inspiration, entails the gift of prophecy, diverse kinds of tongues, and interpretation. Allow me to delve quickly into these three categories of spiritual gifts. The gifts of revelation. The first one we want to consider is the word of knowledge. I was so amazed after the revival week last week. Some of my pastoral team members came and said, "Pastor, I received certain gifts during this week of revival and ministration. Some got the word of knowledge." As they were praying for you, they would see the situation, they would see an issue you're battling with, and as they spoke to some of you, you could actually confirm that that is what you're dealing with, word of knowledge. So God, I believe, over and above healing and other miracles that happened, God released some special gifts of the Holy Spirit into our lives. This PA system must work in Jesus' name. We refuse every interruption in the name of Jesus. And we declare the power of God through all the connections of this media equipment in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The word of knowledge. The word of knowledge is a fragment or a small item of God's knowledge given to a person by the Holy Spirit. This gift gives certain facts and information through supernatural revelation. You get certain facts and information through supernatural revelation. This is not where you do qualitative research methodology. You don't obtain this information by Googling. All your educational research methods will avail for nothing in this aspect. Information is supernaturally given regarding individuals or facts or things like that. It is supernaturally imparted. An example we have is, of course, Acts chapter 9 and verse 10 to 20. John chapter 4 verse 18 to 20. Let me talk about Acts chapter 9. What happened there? You know the story of Ananias and Sapphira?
Yes.
These guys wanted to be a blessing. Alright? They say they will sell their plot, they will sell their piece of land and give all the proceeds for the expansion of the kingdom of God. But when they saw that plot, they saw the check, it was a big check, and they said, "We cannot give all this check. Let's just keep a bit for ourselves." You know, we have to be proactive, we have to be pragmatic and practical. Let's keep a bit of that for ourselves. And so they kept a bit of that for themselves. And when Sapphira and Ananias, to begin with, brought the check, less what they had kept, to Peter, Peter looked him in the eye and said, "Why have you lied to the Holy Spirit? Is this all you sold the land for?" He said, "Yes, man of God, here is the check." And Peter, by word of knowledge, special revelation, he realized that Ananias had acted dishonestly and kept back of what he had consecrated to God. And Peter just told him, "Why have you lied to the Holy Spirit? The whole money was yours. Before you sold it, you made a commitment to give all of it. Why did you hold it back? You had the option of deciding how much to give. You promised, you pledged this much, and you've given less, and you've come to pretend that this is all you sold it for." And what happened? He was struck dead. Unknown to his wife Sapphira, she comes in singing Amenitendea, Amenitendea. And to the apostle asked her, "Is this all you sold the piece of land for?" "Yes, man of God, God is so good, hallelujah. Jehovah turns my life around." She was almost singing it and rejoicing. He said, "Why are you lying? Why have you conspired to lie to the Holy Spirit? The feet of the men who carried away your husband are coming to carry you away." She fell dead. How did Peter know this? Word of knowledge. Now this gift gives guidance and direction, uncovers sins, and imparts knowledge of future events. It reveals hidden things. I need to move on. the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, we have said, a supernatural revelation. It's not research or education or experience. Let's consider the second one, the word of wisdom, or a word of wisdom. This gift enables us to speak and to act with divine wisdom, and thus ensure correct application of our other gifts, okay? It enables us to be able to act with divine wisdom, and therefore we are able to apply other spiritual gifts. In fact, in Paul's list of spiritual gifts is the first one, word of wisdom. Now, word of wisdom is not a spirit or a gift of wisdom. It is called a word of wisdom. This is a special revelation that is released in a specific context, in a specific situation, to give wisdom and insight on what needs to be done. It is not the gift of wisdom, but a word of wisdom given for a specific need or situation. It is the revelation of the purpose of God concerning people. Revelation of the purposes of God concerning people, things, or future events, or looking into the future. The example is Acts chapter 6. Now the church is growing in leaps and bounds, okay? They are now a mega church by all standards. By the time you get to Acts chapter 6, you are looking at 5,000 plus strong congregation. So there are also now new administrative challenges in this early church. Now the Grecian women, we have the Hebraic women, the native of Jerusalem, and then we have Hebraic women, the native ones, then we have the Hellenistic, or women or the, from the Jewish community in the diaspora. So we have the local people in Jerusalem, the indigenous people, but also the Jews from the diaspora. Now, during this revival, the move of God, there was a problem. The Hebraic Jews, the natives, were getting favors and special recognition at the expense of the Hellenistic Jews, those from the diaspora. Maybe they spoke with some accent. Instead of saying the river, they were saying the liver. They had a distinct foreign accent. It was easy to pick them out. So the native, the local, the Hebraic Jews were getting special favors at the expense of those women and the Jews from the diaspora. And this caused a lot of disquietness, discomfort, and murmuring and complaining in this community. So what happened? The apostle said, it's not good for us to pay attention to the tables, distribution of resources. We will give ourselves to prayer and to the word, but we will choose men, six men full of the Holy Ghost, to take charge of these administrative things. That is a word of wisdom.
Amen.
To know what to do in any given enigma, to know what to do in any given paradox and challenge of life, you need a word of wisdom, special understanding released to deal with a given situation. The third gift under the gifts of revelation is the gift of discerning of spirits. It is imparted by the Holy Spirit so that we can see into the spiritual realm to distinguish between the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Satan, and the human spirit. There are three sources of action: either divine through God, or satanic, secondly, or human inspiration. So for you to be able to see into the spiritual realm and distinguish between the action originating from the Holy Spirit, or the action originating from demons, or just a human wish and expression, you need the discerning of spirits. Now, this is not the gift of discernment. It's a discerning of spirits. Three sources of action. An example given is Acts chapter 16 and verse 16. Now Paul was preaching for a while, and there was a girl who in his crusade. And this is what she was saying. These are the servants of the Most High God who are telling you the way to be saved. And the Church of Jesus Christ said, not so soon. She was saying for 3 days, these men are servants of God who are telling you the way to be saved. She kept on doing that until Paul, I believe, gained the discerning of spirits and turned to her and rebuked the evil spirit that was in her, and the girl was set free. This girl had a spirit of divination.
Amen.
And the owner apparently was making a lot of money through her. This was not of the Holy Ghost, it was divination. Why did it take 3 days before the apostle realized she's not part of us? She's being inspired from a different quarter. It takes discernment. Now, this gift is so critical for those who want to be involved in deliverance ministry and the ministry of healing. Sometimes you need to know what you're up against. Is this a medical problem? Is this a spiritual problem? Is this caused by demons? What is the source of this illness or infirmity? You need the discerning of spirits. The gift of discerning of spirits. Don't we need that in the body of Christ?
Yes.
Let me take this opportunity to caution us. Stargazing. Some people are quick when they buy the newspaper, they buy to read the column on stars. Stop that. That is horoscope. Horoscope is hollow. Stargazing, divination, witch doctors, enchantment, those are contrary, fake, counterfeit to the operation of the Holy Spirit. They bring you into satanic bondage. You don't get anything from the devil for free. If you are given into that, today is your day of freedom. God knows what to do in your life and to do and lead and guide you as his child. Hallelujah. You need discerning of spirits. Now let's consider the second category, gifts of power. This entails the gift of faith. The gift of faith is a special endowment given to someone God is calling for impossible assignment. Hallelujah. Someone needs to intercede right now in Jesus' name. The gift of faith is a gift given by the Holy Spirit to someone God is calling for special assignment. You need faith. Hallelujah. This is not general faith. General faith grows with time. You get born again, you continue growing in your faith in Christ. It's not general faith. It is also not saving faith, the initial faith that comes to you when you repent and you turn to God. No, this is very special faith that performs miracles, signs, and wonders in special extenuating circumstances. For example, when Joshua commanded the sun to stand still, that is faith. Until the Amalekites were defeated, the day was running quickly, it was going to evening, and Joshua discovered that the battle is not over. So what did he do? He commanded the sun to stop. So the sun stopped until the battle and the job was done. Also Elijah in 1 Kings 17, what did he do? He told Ahab, no rain in Israel except by my word. No rain in Israel. And there was famine for 3 years in Israel. Word of faith, the gift of faith. Also in the book of Acts 13, 8 to 11, Paul silences Elymas the sorcerer. Elymas the sorcerer was opposed to the things of God, and Paul commanded blindness to strike him. And Elymas the sorcerer was struck with blindness. This is a very special gift that we need to be able to fulfill God's assignment here on earth. The second category under this, the second gift rather under this category is the gifts of healing. Gifts of healing. I'm moving a little faster in the interest of time. The gifts of healing. Now, gifts of healing or healings operate supernaturally to heal diseases and infirmities without natural intervention. Healing, special healing by the power of God without human or natural intervention. Now let me clarify here, church. All healings are from God. An honest doctor, orthopedic surgeon will tell you, once they put together broken bones and put maybe a plate to hold the bones together, they do not do anything beyond that. The bones come together, the cement cements the broken part again, and you're able to have your arm or your leg together or whatever fractured bone. That is divine in some way. The best they do is to put back the bones together. What happens beyond that? It's God. For this purpose, we'll call it natural healing. But the gift of healing does not operate that way. It's supernatural healing without medical assistance. And we thank God for the breakthrough in medical science. We have benefited as humanity. I salute every doctor, every paramedic in the house. God has given you amazing knowledge that is helping humanity. Continue practicing it for the glory and honor of God. However, divine healing, or the gifts of healing, operates differently. It's supernatural healing. Now, the purpose of this gift is to draw people to God. When God healed people in the New Testament, when Jesus did the miracle of healing, what happened? People were drawn to God. They put their faith in God. Hallelujah. This gift brings glory to God. When people saw miracles happening of healing, they praised God and honored God for what he was doing. But this gift also inspires faith and courage in God's people. That is the reason why we testify, to bring glory to God, not to glorify the man of God. The testimonies we heard last week, the hands that have gone up, is not to glorify any pastor here, is to bring glory to God, that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is doing what he promised to do. He's still healing. He's still in the business of saving people and delivering them from demonic and satanic oppression. Amen. God is at work. Amen. There's a group of theologians, we call them cessationists, who propagate the agenda of the things that spiritual gifts have actually ceased. They were only necessary in the first century to get the church off the ground. Now all these gifts and miracles no longer happens. Guess where that comes from? I didn't say that. That is human wisdom and trying to understand the things of God. God is still the same yesterday, today, and forever. The last gift under this category is the working of miracles. Oh, I sense that God is bringing healing today. If you're sick in your body, I pray healing upon you in Jesus' name. God is at work in this congregation. I believe gifts are being released in this season as we focus on the Holy Spirit. He comes in diverse ways to release his gifts upon us. Hallelujah. The working of miracles. 1 Corinthians 12 and number 10. A miracle is a sovereign act of the Holy Ghost irrespective of the laws of systems. A miracle is a sovereign act of the Holy Spirit irrespective of laws or systems. It is a supernatural intervention in ordinary course of nature. When the divinity meets humanity, a miracle happens. When the divinity intercepts a humanity or nature, something spectacular happens. Is a supernatural intervention on ordinary course of nature or circumstances. The gift of the working of miracles comes when God endues us with power to be able to perform supernatural acts for his honor and for his glory. This gift is given for a specific time and for a specific special purpose. For example, the deliverance of God's people from Egyptian bondage. Exodus chapter 15. Prior to that, of course, there was a working of miracles in Egypt when Moses, by the grace of God, stretched his hands and God did amazing miracles in Egypt, almost devastating that country. But when they came to the sea, a big obstacle before them, the Red Sea, what happened? Moses stretched his rod over the water of the Red Sea, and what happened? They parted. That's a working of miracles. They crossed the Red Sea by faith. When the Egyptian decided to pursue them, what happened? They drowned. The waters came back together after Moses stretched his rod over the divided water, and the waters gushed back together, and all the finest of Egypt was drowned. The working of miracles. This gift is also exercised to provide for those in want. It is exercised to meet the need of God's people. Exodus chapter 17. Of course, now they have been sojourning in the wilderness for 3 days, no water. And they cried to Moses, "What are we to do?" They were ready to stone the man of God. "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to come and kill us in the desert? You see, we are almost starving. We are almost getting dehydrated. 3 days, no water." So Moses cried to God, and what did God tell Moses? "It's a rock in Horeb. Just strike it. Strike it." And as Moses struck the rock, what happened? Water gushed out. That's a working of miracles. Working of miracles. So that happens to meet God, the needs of God's people. This gift also provides divine judgment and discipline. It can be exercised to provide divine judgment and discipline. This is what happened to Pharaoh. Pharaoh had many opportunities to repent, but he hardened his heart. And so God stretched his hand through Moses to bring divine judgment upon Egypt. This gift of working of miracles, number four, is also exercised to provide or to confirm the preached word. God, in fact, Jesus promised, "These signs will follow those who believe." What will they do? Speak in new tongues, pick up serpents, and they will not be killed, and miracles will follow them and the like. So the working of miracles serves to confirm the preached word. Hallelujah. To confirm the gospel, and we need confirmation of the gospel, not just in mere eloquence and intellect and human ingenuity. We'll be depriving the cross of its power. Hallelujah. There's power in the gospel of Jesus Christ. When it's faithfully proclaimed, sometimes and often there's an accompaniment of signs and wonders. It confirms the gospel. But also, this gift is exercised just to display God's power and magnificence. God's power, hallelujah. Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands has made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder. Then sings my soul, my Savior, unto you. How great thou art, how great thou art, hallelujah. The works and the wonders of God in nature and the world are supposed to magnify the Lord and cause us to praise Him and to adore Him and to glorify Him. God's magnificence, God's awesome power is displayed through miraculous interventions in the course of nature. The last category, time really fails me. The last category is the gifts of inspiration. The gifts of inspiration. The first one in this category is a gift of prophecy. This is a controversial one. This one, and also tongues. I will try to dwell there a little longer to try and demystify and clarify a little bit of mist that has been associated through with the practice of this gift. Let's begin with the first one, the gift of prophecy. Prophecy means to utter inspired words or declaring the mind of God for the purpose of edifying exalting and comforting. Can I say that again? Prophecy means to utter inspired words or declaring the mind of God for the purpose of edifying, exalting, or comforting. The purpose of this gift is for forth-telling rather than foretelling. The purpose of this gift is for forth-telling, telling it as it is, rather than foretelling, which is predicting. Foretelling has an element of predicting. It's essentially for forth-telling. But if there's an element of prediction in the prophecy, it is all usually associated with another gift, what we call the word of knowledge or word of wisdom. I must say there's an overlap in these spiritual gifts. None works in isolation. There are certain clusters. Depending on one's calling, you may get one or two gifts that work in conjunction with one another. They don't operate in isolation. So there's a bit of overlap between wisdom and word of knowledge, and sometimes also on prophecy. So there's no clear demarcation between these gifts. This gift is not for personal guidance. It is not intended for. There are people in this city. At the beginning of the year, they go to look for men of God to give them a word for the season. What is God saying to me? And if you look for those prophets, there are many in town. Some of them can tell you whether your name is written in the book of life or not. If you give more money, they will tell you it's written there twice, actually. The gift of prophecy is not for personal guidance. Many people have been shipwrecked. They have shipwrecked their faith because of running to these fortune tellers in the name of the men of God, who make a kill, who make a living from predicting and saying stuff that are not inspired by the Holy Spirit. If you need guidance, seek God. Jesus said, "My sheep hears my voice." If you're one in the flock, you'll hear the voice of the Master. You hear the voice of God. Hallelujah. The shepherd is speaking. God speaks to us through His word. He also will inspire us inwardly through His Spirit. We will know the mind of God through the Holy Spirit. So we don't need special guidance. Prophecy only comes to confirm what God is already telling you. It comes to confirm what God is already telling you. So God is speaking. Hear Him. Seek Him. Prophecy comes to confirm what God has told you. 1 Corinthians 14:29, Paul giving instructions regarding this gift. Let two or three prophets speak, and let the other judge. In other words, weigh the gift. Don't consume prophecy wholesome. It's not whole grain for breakfast. Judge it. Weigh it. Prophecy should be judged or weighed. How do you weigh prophecy? There are five criteria for judging prophecy. One is, it should not contradict the written word of God. It should not contradict God's written word. God cannot tell you, now you're married. When you married out of the will of God. Now that you're born again, leave that woman alone. Marry another one who is saved, who is talking and demon chasing. That will be the perfect will of God. High class nonsense. What God has put together, let no man put asunder. Is that doctrine in town? Are you married out of the will of God? Now that you are born again, ditch her or ditch him. That's the wisdom of demons. If it contradicts God's word, forget it. Secondly, it should always exalt Jesus. Prophecy should glorify Jesus, not the man of God. I was prophesying even in town that Nairobi is going to sink by a big earthquake. Then you will know that I'm a man of God. Who was being exalted? Not Jesus. The emoji. Prophecy must exalt Jesus, not the man of God. Prophecy should edify believers. It should encourage us. Prophecy is for encouraging us and comforting us. If there's an element of rebuke, it is done in love. It doesn't condemn people. If a prophet is condemning you, guess where his inspiration is coming from? If there's sin, you're living in sin, and the man of God comes to challenge you, at best, it should convict you and not condemn you. Conviction leads you to repentance. Condemnation leads you to judgment. Number four, it should be witnessed. There must be a witness among the majority. There are times God speaks and you can have an inner witness. You feel it. You know God is speaking. But if someone is saying, "Thus says the Lord," and you feel like it's sounding like brass, forget it. There has to be an inner witness, because the utterance is inspired by the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit within you will bear witness. If it has a predictive aspect, then it will come to pass. Prophecy has a predictive aspect to it, it will come to pass. I wish we had more time. Time fails me. Number eight, the gifts of the gift of tongues. This is another controversial one. The gift of tongues. 1 Corinthians 12:10-11. To another, different kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. 1 Corinthians 14:5. I would like every one of you to speak in tongues, but I would rather have you prophesy. He who prophesies is greater than those who speak in tongues, unless he interprets, so that the church may be edified. 1 Corinthians 14:2-3. For anyone who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men but to God. Indeed, no one understands him. He utters mysteries within his spirit. He utters mysteries within the spirit. Let me just say this quickly. The gift of tongues has two aspects. The first aspect is what we call devotional tongues. Devotional tongues. The tongues you say in your devotional life, where you worship and you pray in the spirit, you honor God, you intercede in the spirit. So those are what we call devotional tongues. And the Bible says, he who speaks in a known tongue does not speak to men, but speaks to God. He utters mysteries to God. He glorifies God. He speaks wonders in the heavenly realm. The mind does not profit. The body does not profit. The world does not profit, because these are special utterances directed to God. Hallelujah. Those are devotional tongues, and we need to speak in tongues. When you speak in those devotional tongues, you edify yourself, you build yourself up in the most holy faith. Some of us are weak spiritually because we do not exercise this gift of devotional tongues. But there's a second aspect of this gift. In conjunction with the companion gift of interpretation of tongues, this gift can be used to edify the body of Christ. A prophetic word can come in form of tongues. In this case, there must be interpretation, so that we are encouraged, we are exalted, we are edified. There must be interpretation. Amen?
Amen.
This happened in the day of Pentecost. They spoke in new tongues. Amen? Let's not despise speaking in tongues. It builds you up. You utter mysteries. A lot is accomplished in the spiritual realm when you pray in tongues, when you worship in tongues, when you intercede in tongues. I believe these mysteries that happen in the spiritual realms. Some people experience healing and freedom when they speak in tongues. Interestingly, I think I need to close with this illustration. Jackie Pulitzer, a British missionary who went to Hong Kong in the 60s to go and reach out to the drug addicts, heroin addicts, had little success for 2 years in the streets of Hong Kong until she began to pray in tongues 15 minutes at least at every day. Then the converts, these addicts began to give their life to Christ, and she started encouraging them to speak in tongues. And she discovered those ones who begin speaking in tongues after conversion, they get tremendously changed and delivered from addiction and hangovers. The authorities in Hong Kong realized the enormous work she was doing. In fact, the success rate of her rehab through conversion, their faith in Christ and speaking in tongues, was higher than the hospitals in Hong Kong, higher than psychologists and psychiatrists' intervention. The authorities in Hong Kong gave her acres of property to do her missionary work. The Queen of England before that, BBC, very skeptical international media house, got wind of what was happening, and they came to interview her and do some investigative journalism. And they confirmed that the figures of success rate and deliverance was not exaggerated. The miracles were happening. The drug addicts were delivered completely. As soon as they get born again, they begin to speak in new tongues. They didn't need to go through withdrawal symptoms, no medical intervention. Now, the best is yet to come. The Queen of England heard about this, and they gave her the highest recognition, Order of the British Empire, OBE. She's been decorated. You can Google her, Jackie Pulitzer. There's interviews on the internet. You can find all that info available. Because this woman recognized the anointing of the Holy Ghost and the gift of the Holy Ghost, how that can intervene in human extenuating and unfortunate circumstances to bring deliverance, freedom, and hope.
Amen.
I have to stop.
Amen.
I have no time to talk about the other gifts. We need the Holy Spirit. I don't know how best I can put this. The world needs the Holy Spirit. The world needs the gifts of the Holy Spirit to be effective and to extend God's kingdom here on earth. We need the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Let's be upstanding music team. You can come over here. Hallelujah.
I believe that God has spoken to you so personally through this message. If you want to give your life to Jesus, please allow me the privilege and the benefit of ushering you to the kingdom of God. Repeat this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, I thank you for loving me and dying for me at the cross of Calvary. Today, I recognize I am a sinner. I turn away from my sin and I embrace you as my Lord and my Savior. In your wonderful and precious name, I pray with thanksgiving. Amen. You know what? If you say that prayer from the bottom of your heart, you're born again, you're a child of God, your sins are forgiven, and your name now is in the Lamb's Book of Life. Find a Bible-believing church and be part of God's family wherever you live. God bless you. Amen and amen. Amen.